Your Holiness, thank you very much for joining us today. It's lovely to be here with you. This is your first trip to the Northern Territory, which has a very high population of Aboriginal people. What were your impressions of this land and the people?
And Native people?
Yes, the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people of Australia.
Now, modern world, not like the past. I think the concept of equal. And also, there are people who really is showing, concern, preservation of the local people's culture. In many parts of the world, situation there. So now the local people, the community, what do you call it, the original people, now must work hard with self-confidence, education, and some training, and they must build their own community, their own home, modernized home, and modernized society. Meantime, keep their own spirit, their own culture, and their own language. Many years ago, I met some Australian native representative in Europe many years ago. I met. Then I suggested the native people must have their own traditional name. That I think should keep. Dress change through education. I think some way is in their way of thinking, way of life change. But as a sort of reminder, I think better to keep their own traditional name. Wherever they go, it's on their address, it's in their own traditional name. I think that also, I think, one way to preserve. Mm-hmm. Like the Tibetan, a young Tibetan, born in outside, educated, so their whole lifestyle, like modern person, but carry Tibetan name.
Mm-hmm. And what did you think of Kevin Rudd's apology when he said sorry to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people? What are your thoughts on that?
That's very good. At that time, when I heard that, I praised. That's very good. That's realistic. Now some kind of discrimination, same human being, due to color or due to some small thing. That's, of course, outdated, old-fashioned. So the government, this act timely. This is very right.
Very enough. Mm-hmm. Very enough.
And also I wrote the letter, sort of for today, my sort of expression of appreciation. Like that.
Mm-hmm. And can you share your thoughts on Uluru? I believe the plane flew around Uluru yesterday before you arrived in Darwin. It's a very sacred and spiritual place for Aboriginal people, and it holds very much significance for our people here. What are your thoughts on that place?
Of course, since many years, I saw a picture of that, and I know. You see, it is something like heart of the whole this continent. And the indigenous people is considered that something very, very sacred and very important spiritual sort of site. So then, yesterday, the airplane, the pilot, arranged, he deliberately tried to show, you see, that the airplane go like that.
Mm.
So you see, from a different sort of city, dimension, I saw very beautiful. Then immediately I asked the in future, I one time in future, an occasion is to visit Australia. I must go visit that site, and I would like to participate. Some of the local people, some of the indigenous people, sort of say, there. I think there must be some sort of ceremony, something like that. I want to participate.
Mm-hmm.
Me personally, no connection, but I always respect the different sort of cultural heritage. So from that sort of my sort of commitment, I would like to go there and show my respect, like that.
Okay. So I've attended many of your public teachings and I've discovered that you've got a great sense of humour and you're very playful on stage. Were you able to be playful as a child, even though from the age of 5 you were given the big responsibility of being the Dalai Lama?
I think, firstly, my mother, very, very kind. And then, so I grown up under sort of immense sort of affection from our mother, and the rest of my brother sisters also received immense sort of affection. And then after I reached Lhasa, the people whom I daily met, including sweepers, very innocent people but very warm-hearted person. And in ceremony, sort of case, of course, formal case, they also respect me. But when we met privately or sort of usually, you see, they treated me as a sort of another human, young human being. So we played together. They don't care, Dalai Lama. So they sometimes defeat me when we play. So sometimes I cry because defeated.
Sometimes so you didn't win.
We really, you see, develop really very sort of happy sort of atmosphere. So I grown up that way. And then also I think training about mind, about the sort of warm-heartedness. So I combine these things.
Mm-hmm. You have millions of followers around the world, and in Australia you've proven to be a very popular and spiritual leader amongst those our Indigenous people here in this country, and they feel a very close affinity with you and with Tibetans who have also been dispossessed from their lands, and we're fighting for our cultural survival. Do you feel a closeness with Indigenous Australians?
Yes, some similarities and also differences. Indigenous people in their own land, we now outside. yes, there are some similarities, there are differences also. I think one aspect of similarity is to try to preserve our own culture, our own language, like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we've also it's and loss as of language.
As I mentioned earlier, one time I met some indigenous people in Latin America. Which country now? I can't remember. Indigenous people.
Mm-hmm.
You see, they so much concerned about the preservation of their own language, their own way of life. So they prefer remain isolated from the modern society. Then I told them, that's wrong. The preservation of your own identity, your own culture, through modern education, through modernized, and then preserve these things. is this more realistic, more effective? The intention want to keep their own tradition. For that reason, isolate is actually self-destruction, not good. So we committed fully about modern education and these things. So as I mentioned earlier, you see the indigenous people here also, you see, should pay more attention about modern education and the technology. Modernization is important. Meantime, keep your own language, your own spirit like that.
Mm. So you think education is the key to helping our plight here
yes,
in this country?
Yes, that's right. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Your destiny was set to be the spiritual leader of Tibet and Buddhism from the age of two. Did you ever question this path that was chosen for you?
What do you mean?
Did you?
Yes.
Yeah, you were chosen as the spiritual leader from the age of two. Did you ever question, because you were very, very young, have you ever questioned
that? There are such traditions there. And one, I think, advantage is once you choose your destination or something, then special sort of what's the advantage for study, for practice. And also the person himself or herself also you see get some kind of deeper responsibility, sense of responsibility. In positive sense, that's a good. So sometimes the people ask me, you see, being as a Dalai Lama, or what really I feel, or any wishes in not this kind of sort of situation. Then that is already now I become a Dalai Lama. So is it better to utilize you see, that situation rather than just this wish, oh, I should not be Dalai Lama like that. It's silly. And then also is there some advantage also there. And also is there some sort of danger with sort of certain name and the popularity also there. Sometimes you see, spoil yourself or over blind self-confidence. Sometimes it's a danger to develop. Many people praising you, then you feel, oh, I'm something very special. There are such danger also there. So as a Buddhist monk, I always describe myself as a simple Buddhist monk. In my daily life, particularly when I give some talk, particularly on throne, from throne, I always is watching my mind. Oh, be careful, be careful. You should be an honest, sincere Buddhist monk, Buddhist practitioner. That's important. And sometimes I notice this, some people, among Tibetan also, this is some Tibetan gradually become quite sort of, how should I say, popular, or many people who follow that person. Then sometimes the person change their sort of behavior. Sometimes. And then political leaders also, sometimes those great revolutionary people, like Chairman Mao Zedong. I believe in the initial sort of period, I think Chairman Mao Zedong and these people are really dedicated people, wonderful people. Gradually, the power come in their hand. Then, unless you have strong sort of sense of self-discipline and watch yourself constantly, then there is danger to spoil by power.
So, what are your memories of life in a free Tibet?
So, happy. But you see, up to my age 15, then problem started. So I think 13, 14, perhaps I think the best, most happiest sort of period. But then, okay, like that. And one my what is it, the my belief or my concept, all human beings are same. Actually, 7 billion human beings, same. So oneness of humanity. I believe that. Of course, our practice, our prayer, always say, entire sentient being, entire mother sentient being. So that concept, if you implement, very helpful to mix very easy with other people and consider others also just human brothers, sisters. I never feel I'm something sort of different person and some kind of distance. I never feel that. So this is very, very helpful. Whether in your own country or different country, so long this country of a human being, same, basically same, not much differences.
So when you were just a teenager, you became the political leader of Tibet. And as there were expectations at the time, the Chinese were going to seize control of the capital and there were concerns for your safety. What was this time like for you during that national uprising?
Oh, that's after 9 years since the Chinese Liberation Army came to Tibet. That was 1951. Then 54, I went to Peking and met all the Chinese communist leaders, and particularly Chairman Mao Zedong, several times I met. Really wonderful. I really, developed genuine respect, genuine admiration, and trust. But then I returned with full trust or full hope, 1955, 54. Autumn, I went there. Then, I think May or June, 55, I returned. But then, end of that year, or beginning of 56, then some uprising start in eastern part of Tibet under Chinese jurisdiction, different from Chinese provinces. Then that eventually increasing, spread, first eastern part, then gradually northeast. Then around, I think, 58, 57, 57, 58, then gradually reach in central Tibet. That's so-called autonomous region of Tibet, the Tibet under Tibetan government jurisdiction. Then 58. Things become really difficult. Then, 59 March, there's uprising happen like that.
And what was it like for you and your people? What was it like for you and your people at that time? How did you feel?
Much tense. And also, I think many people feel anger or the immense adversity, grievance. So grievance, frustration, often used to translate or transform anger. Very sad. So those years, I try my best, to keep cool and with belief, non-violence. And then even 10th March crisis happened. Then my place, Nobulinga, they're surrounded by people. This is supposed to protect me and also not allow me go to some Chinese sort of military base like that. So, 10th March afternoon, crisis, about noon, it happened. Then next, about 1 week, I try my best to cool down, but it failed. Then 17th, afternoon, I decide. Now, no longer, you see, the use, now things no longer use also this effort. Now, there's real danger of my own life. So then, there's no other choice except escape. And escape also, you see, not very sure. When I living in Nobulinga, my place, about 10 o'clock, Thasa time, p.m., 10 o'clock. So although we left, but not very sure, next morning, next day, can see or not. Really, very, very dangerous situation. Then somehow, we survived.
But how did it feel to be forced to have to flee your own country?
So that very day, you see, we calculate if remain there, what will happen? If through escape and survived, at that time, not thinking go to India, but southern Tibet. Then soon after I left, bombarded Lhasa. And also, you see, Chinese Liberation Army, you see, pursue towards southern Tibet. And then there's no other choice, you see, except come to India. And also, you see, we are not very sure whether Indian government allowed or not. So, you see, we try Bhutan side and Indian side. Then as soon as we received the indication Indian government ready to receive us, then we straightly, you see, approach to Indian border.
Did you feel very sad, though, that you had to leave your own country? You couldn't stay there any longer?
Yes, some sort of emotion, emotionally, some feeling. The next morning, when I passing one pass, then you see, I turned to Lhasa and Potala. There's some kind of final expression of goodbye. This is sad, but doesn't matter. We have to think with the sort of purpose. If remain there, if I die, then not my sorrow. Better to survive.
It could have been very dangerous for you to stay.
Oh,
yeah, better to survive.
And then also, you see, become like the late Panchen Lama. He left there. Then. Next few years, he acting like a puppet. Then he also house arrest. Next, I think 9 years or something like that. So later, you see, some of my officials, immediate after we reach India, some officials feel a little sort of city. Not very sure that decision whether become right or wrong. Then gradually situation become more difficult, and particularly cultural revolution started. Then those Tibetan trusted officials among my entourage, you see, they who have some reservation about that decision. Then everybody say, now 17th March decision become very right.
Okay, so it's been over 60 years since you've been dispossessed from your homeland, and this is also something that Indigenous...
No, 54 years now.
Yeah?
Not 60.
Okay. Well, it's been a very, very long time since you've been away from your home. And it's something that Indigenous Australians face here, dispossession of land and their loss of culture. How do you view this common fight for the right for Indigenous peoples to live on their own homeland and to practice their own culture and language.
That was already discussed now, Vera. That is a very right. Now, very good opportunity. Now, Australian government already recognized this past mistake. So now you have the, I think legally, you have right. Is it to rebuild your home, modernize home.
Mm-hmm. And there are reports.
I very much impressed the Maori people in New Zealand. You see, they equally sort of participate in the field of law, economy, and many fields. So now people here also, you see, should make effort to use opportunity become equal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there are very high suicide rates in Indigenous communities here in Australia. A lot of young people, our young people are taking their own lives. And in Tibet, there are self-immolations that have made, you know, world headlines since 2009. Our people are taking desperate measures, even though taking one's own life is against our, you know, cultural beliefs. How do you encourage these people to take a more positive approach during these oppressive times?
I think different cases, I think. The, yes, here, I think the native people suicide, this may be personal sort of problem. Like in Japan, also many countries, is young people suicide, cases of suicide, now increasing the rate of suicide. The rate is increasing. But these are mainly the individual sort of difficulties or some sort of mental sort of problems. Those Tibetan case, not like that. I think really is in the well, the main sort of concern, main sort of grievance.
Mm.
Because of the overwhelming sort of situation.
Mm-hmm.
Some hardliner Chinese communist, you see, they consider Tibetan Buddhist faith is source of danger of separation.
Mm-hmm.
So accordingly, now I think one party secretary, I remember, if correctly, Teng Kuen, when he take the party secretary responsibility. Now, one party meeting, he mentioned the ultimate source of threat, Tibet being separate from China, is Tibetan Buddhist faith. So, around that period, after he take the responsibility, you see, restrictions in monastery and political education, these things is much tightened. So at that time, some Tibetan express, now some kind of culture revolution, a semi-culture revolution, now returning. So that these are the real sort of factor, the 2008 years crisis. Now these, I think, sad things also, I think, continuation. But of course, they're very sad. The other day, I mentioned it is better, live. Take one's own life. It's an end. Particularly those young, determined so people, I think much better alive, and they can do more.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It's been over 200 years since European colonization in Australia, and it's been over 60 years since China invaded Tibet. Both cultures are fighting for their human rights and freedom to practice their cultural traditions. How can we remain hopeful for true reconciliation with non-Indigenous people here in this country? And how do you continue to hope reconcile with Chinese and your dream of an autonomous Tibet?
Now again, indigenous people, when first the European come, are completely strange. relation between China and Tibet, almost 2,000 years, that kind of relations there. The 7th century, 8th century, 9th century. Then, you see, there's some historians say three powerful sort of kingdom or regimes, China, Tibet, Mongol. So we are, I think the last almost 2,000 years, you see, very familiar each other. Mm-hmm. And so the even marriage, 7th century, Chinese princess married with Tibetan emperor, like that. And then religiously also, you see, many Chinese emperor actually receiving teaching from Tibetan Lama. So some very, very unique close relations. That's depend on political sort of thinking. The communist, the political thinking is a non-religious. And then also totalitarian system. But here, Australia, the British imperialist, bad, but still democratic country. Rule of law, independent judiciary. I always telling my Indian friend, like Mahatma Gandhi, these freedom fighter, from prison, they can appeal according to law. So, the Western colonialist rule, sometimes I think a little bit sort of, I think as far as I noticed, the Portugal colonization in Brazil, more harsh. And also I think we can judge those same colonial sort of area in Africa, under British colonial rule, seems to be better education. So I think, so these are, you see, there are similarities and there are sort of differences. But in any way, past is past. Now we have to look forward, future. Now here, you are Commonwealth country, and basically a democratic country. So it seems I got impression now election period. So every people is very busy. So this is the one sort of the experience of democratic sort of system. Nice, nice, and then rule of law, and economically quite good potential. So I think future of Australia, I think very bright.
Mm-hmm. You remain hopeful of an autonomous Tibet?
Now China, the Tibetan situation very much related with development in China proper. So now, last over 60 years, many things, you see, sometimes a little better, like early 80s, when Hu Yanfan there, things really very, very hopeful. But then he soon disgraced. And then also it's the early 50s, when Chairman Mao and in those communists, their mind something very fresh about revolution and serving people, working class people, very fresh. At that time, really very, very hopeful. So I myself also, you see, so convinced about Marxism and the Communist Party. So at that time, I asked the Chinese authority, concerned authority, I would like to join Chinese Communist Party. So still, as far as socio-economic theory is concerned, I am Marxist. now, you see, there are many indications. And particularly many my friend, Chinese friend, you see, many of them say Now, the new leadership, you see, their way of thinking, comparatively much more open, much more realistic. So as things are being statement, seeking truth from fact, this is a very scientific, very realistic approach. So I hope the present leadership should follow or implement sincerely Deng Xiaoping's sort of slogan, seeking truth from fact. Now, in order to make clear about reality, real situation must sort of disclose. Censorship is totally against the policy of seeking truth from fact. So censor and distorted information. Now, for example, one year ago, I was in Japan. The island, which some sort of was some dispute, China and Japan. Actually, I told, now this should solve through sort of talk. But the Chinese, some media reported Dalai Lama support Japan position. So, distorted sort of information. Then I have to deny, I have to mention what I actually stated in Japan. Like that, distorted information. And then also you see some Chinese officials, hardliner, they describe me as a demon. So you should judge this simple Buddhist monk with a demon or not.
No, definitely not.
So when I heard you see that accusation, and I responded, yes, I'm demon with horn, dangerous.
No, definitely not.
So censorship, you see, I think self-destruction. Mm-hmm. 1.3 billion Chinese people, historically, wonderful people, realistic, hardworking, cultured people. So the censorship is actually fooling these people. The people have every right to know the reality. And also, see, once the Chinese people knows the reality, they also have the ability to judge what is right, what is wrong. So then, what is the basis of censorship?
Okay, well, Your Holiness, thank you very much for joining us today. It's been lovely to meet you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.